Stillwater's ASMR. I am filming this video with baby in my lap and she's sitting there staring at me. So I apologize if there's weird grunting noises during this video. Oh, big sigh. I'm hoping that she's on board with the ASMR concept and that she keeps any noises to a gentle, quiet sound the moment she's got her plug in. So this is another video shot in my pyjamas. It is 4:15 in the afternoon and I'm trying to get this video filmed before my husband gets home from work. Oh, I'm getting smiles. Do you like ASMR? I hope so. Yeah, basically I'm going to be busy for the next few days. And so I wanted to get this video done. I'm not getting a chance over the next probably 3 days to do any videos because I'm heading down to town tomorrow. And where I live on like an island, it's just too far to get, so I'm getting little smiles, she's being really cute. It's too far to travel in one day. Well, normally it's not. For a normal person, it's not a problem to pop down, do a grocery shop or, you know, some Christmas shopping and come back, but considering me and baby don't tend to get up till about 10 o'clock, then it would just be, by the time we got ourselves organised and out the door, it would be time to come back home again. So we're going to cheat and we're going to go down and stay the night at my in-law's house. And then we can get in and get some Christmas shopping done, some grocery shopping done before we come back home again on Wednesday. And my baby's looking very happy, it's very adorable. And then Thursday we've got like doctor's checkups. It's meant to be 6 week checkups, but it's gonna be 7 weeks. But yeah, so I won't be able to get any videos done. So I really wanted to get one done today, even though I haven't had a chance to even brush my hair. I don't care, but let's get a video done and get it uploaded to show you how far behind with life in general I am. I've just finished making a pumpkin pie that was meant to have been made for Thanksgiving like several weeks ago, and so I'm just a little bit behind life in general. I'm trying to just get things done at appropriate times when I can. So this video, I kind of wanted to chat to you guys. Oh, are we gonna start making noises? I kind of want to chat to you guys about if you hear weird like sucking noises, then that's maybe sucking our dummy. I just want to chat to you guys about ADHD. So a while back I did a video where I was chatting about how I'd found some research that spoke about Crohn's and ADHD, like there being a link. But at that point I didn't think I had proper ADHD, because proper ADHD is something that you're born with. So it's just who you are, it's just how you're wired. So it doesn't develop. It's also what you catch. It's something that is just who you are and how you are. And I was like, well, no, I didn't have ADHD as a kid. I've since been learning a lot more about ADHD, and specifically ADHD in girls. And it presents very differently to the stereotypical ADHD that you think of, like, which is what ADHD presents in boys. So when you think of the hyperactive kid running around making lots of noise, that is that's the kind of more masculine presentation of it, whereas in girls also presents quite differently.
Yes, it does. Yes, yes, it does.
I can't have all the smiles today. And so, yeah, the more I researched it, the more I discovered that, for example, girls, the things I can see in my childhood that I had ADHD was I was really chatty. Like, the only times I got in trouble at school was for chatting. I couldn't sit still, I could sit in one spot for like hours on end, but I wouldn't be still while sitting there. So it wasn't like I was getting up, running around the room. I have no idea if how much her grunting is going to be interrupting the video. I hope it's not too bad. So I maybe wasn't getting up and running around the room. I'd always be fidgeting in my seat, and it used to drive my dad nuts because I used to sit and read a lot as a kid, and I'd be sitting picking at my face and things, and my dad would be like, "Would you stop that?" Or at the dinner table, I'd be like bouncing a leg, like diddling and just like fidgeting, and it used to really annoy my dad. Also quite poor impulse control. Like, my brother used to laugh. So there was a while when I was a kid, my brother was home ill, and he had ME, or postural fatigue. He was very, very sick, and he'd be at home, like, for, he did like a couple of years of school at home, and my dad, when he was home from sea, would be at home too with him, and they would have had a nice, quiet, peaceful day, and my brother could literally count down to how long it would take for me to get in the front door from school and my dad to yell at me, because I would just be like, my dad had just a simple request of me that I'd come in, I'd put my jacket in the closet, I'd put my bag away in my room, and I'd come and talk to him about my day, like, calmly and rationally. I would be bursting with all the "this is what happened today," that I would come bursting in the door, I'd dump my jacket and my bag on the floor and just burst into the room and picked up, and my dad would just every single day would be like, yell at me, and I couldn't contain myself. I'd been holding it in all day and I'd be like bursting. And then whenever I had friends around, I would get super hyper and loud and noisy. My dad would put me in timeouts, which was so embarrassing. And he'd make me like stand, like either sit in a rocking chair or stand facing the wall, being quiet for a while until I calmed down. And it was just mortifying. So these are things that I can see now that as a kid were indicators of ADHD. The reason why I never got flagged as a kid, though, was because most of the time ADHD goes hand in hand with poor academic performance, because kids find it hard to concentrate at school. But the thing is, for me, I loved school. There's three things that help ADHD people to concentrate. Time pressure, something that's new, or something that's of genuine interest to them. And I found that school, I loved school because I loved learning, so that was something that was of interest to me. And then also I liked doing lots of different subjects, because then you're always getting something new and something fresh. So like, in a school day you wouldn't be doing one thing the whole day, you'd be doing maybe some history and then some maths and then some music, and I really enjoyed going between the different subjects, and I enjoyed all the subjects that I did. I loved school, I loved learning, and so that worked really well for me. So I did well academically because I found it interesting. I loved university, my grades started to kind of and that's when I started to struggle. Oh, apologies. And so I never got flagged up as having a problem growing up because I was doing well academically, which some people with ADHD can. I can since see in my adult life certain ways in which it's, so that's it, like as a kid, as a young girl, how it manifested. As an adult now, there's certain ways where I really notice its impact in my life. So one is the distraction. If, say for example, I put a pizza in the oven for 15 minutes, and then I'm like, right, okay, I've got 15 minutes, I'll just quickly go and do just, I don't know, like, even just nip to the loo. Just a simple act of going and doing something else. Chances are I will forget that I've put the pizza in the oven, or when I put the pizza in the oven, or I'll get distracted by other things, and then the pizza's gonna burn, like guaranteed. Like the number of times I've said to somebody, I'll phone you back in 5 minutes, and then I've gone and done something else and completely forgotten that I was gonna phone them back in 5 minutes. And yeah, it's this is a real problem because we used to have a solid fuel ray burn in the kitchen that needed to be fed regularly. Oh, baby's feeling unhappy. Apologies if you can hear that. That's the baby and not me. I'd like to clarify. So we had a solid fuel ray burn in the kitchen, and you had to constantly be putting, like every few hours, you had to put something on it. I would go and get engrossed in something and clean forget about it, and so it would die. Or if it's gone kind of really low and it's only got like slight embers, if you put some fuel in, so whether it's wood or peats, and then opened up like the bottom of it and the back of it, it would let the air through and it would get the fire going again. I would, but you only want to do that for like just like a few minutes for it to get going, and then you close it back up. I would open it up, toddle off, forget all about it, go get engrossed in something else, and like everything would burn down, like not the house, but like the everything that I put into the fire that's supposed to last like a good couple hours would be burned away in like half an hour because I would have forgotten about it, and then the fire would go out again. So there's like the dual factor here. The one is the being distracted away and forgetting about things. The other is a hyper focus. So if I'm working on something, I will forget everything else. So if I've put out washing, but then I go and start working, like studying or something, and I'm really engrossed in what I'm doing, and it starts to rain, I will not notice and I'll forget that I've hung out while washing out. So that's where you can see on my day-to-day, whenever I've got a lot of things I'm trying to do at once, like you put a load of washing in the washing machine and then go and start doing something else, I'll forget about that and then it's not getting hung out. So that's a real, and there's a lot of that in daily life. There's a lot of that kind of having to do multiple things, like multitasking. I can't do it. I'm terrible. So there's like that distraction, but there's also the getting absorbed in something. If I am reading a good book, I will get completely sucked into it, to the detriment of everything else in my life. Like, I won't want to sleep, I won't want to do chores, I won't want to go to work. Like, I will be so engrossed in this book, it will just be all consuming. So I've actually, as a kid, I used to read over like 100 books a year. As an adult, hardly read, because I don't dare read, because if I get into a good book, I really struggle to have the control to put it down and get on with other things in my life. So it's only on the rare occasions when I have like a day I can afford just to write off like a whole day or weekend, depending on how long the book is. And that doesn't really happen as an adult. Then This one really affects me. Say I've got an appointment at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and it's currently 11 o'clock. Even though I've got several hours before my appointment, I'll be too scared to start things. Because say, right, the appointment's at 2, it's currently 11 o'clock, I've got a task that I need to do that'll take half an hour. There's plenty of time for me to do that task before 2 o'clock, but I'll be really apprehensive about starting that task, because I'm like, it'll stress me out, because I'm very aware that I've got this thing at 2 o'clock. Or the flip side of that is, I'll think I've got plenty of time to do something, and I'll start doing something, and then I end up being late, because I've completely misjudged how long it'll take me to get ready and to get there and all that kind of stuff. So the number of times I will be late for things because I've just completely misjudged how long getting ready and getting there and everything would be. So that's another aspect. So there's quite a few things that I can really see the ADHD affects me daily. I went to the doctors and asked for a referral to get like an ADHD assessment, because you can get an assessment to determine whether or not you have ADHD. And so I put myself forward for one of these. And so the doctor referred me to the mental health team, or the psychology unit, or whatever team it is that deals with it, because it's not really mental health, it's more just how your brain's wired. And they had a look, and they got back to me. And basically, here in the UK, then the NHS, you can go private and you can pay and have whatever done you want, but if you want it done on the NHS, the only real treatment they offer people with ADHD here in the UK on the NHS is medication. And just like autism, ADHD is a spectrum. And it's like there's some people who are more severely affected than others. And also they also say that it's normal behaviours, but that are blown out of, like, that are like bigger and more exaggerated than like normal people. So normal people will procrastinate and forget things and all this kind of stuff. But someone with ADHD will just have it worse. One important concept of ADHD, which I guess is like a big part of it that I haven't mentioned so far, is that ADHD people need external motivation to do things. So for example, I got a cat during the Sophia. So for example, we need like a schedule or a deadline or someone else breathing down our necks to motivate us to get things done. Just because we want to do it isn't often enough. We kind of lack that internal motivation to get things done, which just means you have to get a bit creative when there's things that you want to get done, but don't have like a deadline or someone chasing you for it. You kind of have to create artificial deadlines or get somebody told you accountable, because that internal motivation is kind of lacking. It's like you know the things that you need to do, but you just can't do them. And it's really frustrating. And I mean, the more I've been learning about it, the more I'm like, oh my goodness, this is me. So anyway, I asked for this referral, and the psychology team, or whatever they're called, came back, and their response was basically, they only do, because the only course of treatment is medication, they only do assessments for people who they reckon are severely affected by ADHD and therefore would be looking to be medicated. wouldn't be going on the medication route, but you'd instead be going down like the maybe talking therapy or using tools and that kind of thing to help you kind of self-manage. For those people, what they say to them is, if you feel that you have it, like if there's symptoms that you relate to and you believe you have it, then you probably do. Just assume that you do. And then they gave me like a link to some resources to go in and learn more so I can self-manage better. But they were like, but we won't do an assessment. Because assessments are quite, I guess, expensive. They're quite time and labour intensive. They do a lot of digging. And so I guess they just say that, you know, we'll not bother doing them unless you're severely affected. And they were like, well, you've gotten a degree in the past, you've kept a job, you've, you know, done well for yourself, so you're not severely affected. But there's things you can do sort of in your own time and space. So I was actually quite happy with that, that they weren't just saying, no, you don't have it. They were saying, yeah, you probably do, but it's not severe enough for you that we'll go down this assessment route and diagnose it. Because you know, I don't want to be medicated for it anyway, I'm breastfeeding. And I don't want any more medication in my body, so I'm like, yeah, no, I'm good with that. So it's just been interesting though, being really aware of how, like, the more I've been learning, the more I'm learning, like, about ADHD, I'm able to see how it affects my life and sort of better manage myself and my symptoms and better cope with it. And so far, I think I've been coping quite well with having a baby, and because that was, I think, one of the biggest things, because I kind of had the light bulb moment of realizing that I probably had ADHD just before I had the baby, and I was really worried at how I was going to cope with having a baby and ADHD. Actually, I've been coping quite well. I think I've set realistic expectations for myself, and there's certain things I do to try and keep track of things. So for example, I'm big on my lists to be able to keep track of what I need to be doing in a day, and there's actually an app. So Miss Vindicat mentioned it in a video just the other day, and it's an app called Habitica, and it's gamifying your life. There's a few apps that do it, but that's the one that I downloaded, and I think she downloaded it as well. And basically, you take all the habits and chores and like routine stuff that you need to do, and you turn it into a game. Because basically, so the three things that people with ADHD thrive doing is things with a deadline, things that are new, and things that interest them. The things that people with ADHD struggle to do, things that are boring, and things that are repetitive, like chores. And so things like, you know, your repetitive chores that aren't very thrilling but need to be done. That's things that people with ADHD kind of more struggle with more, or things that don't have a deadline. So I have been using the app to try and help me to, like, for example, there's certain things that need to be done every day that I've been really bad about doing, even if it's things for my own benefit. I was being really bad about keeping on top of. So I'm trying to have it in the app. Things like do the dishes, do the cat's litter trays, brush my teeth, all that kind of stuff. And it sounds really stupid and really obvious, but the app really helps, because if you don't do the things, then you get penalised. And then if you're part of it, I'm part of like a group, like a party, that goes on quests. So if I don't do it, the whole group gets penalised. which is one of the things that helps motivate someone with ADHD is having an external ability to help provide that external motivation. But yeah, checklists where you can tick off things that need to be done, that really helps. And also really trying to focus on, because especially having had a baby, that really magnifies, like, my days just slip away from me without me even noticing where they've gone. And it's really quite challenging to get, like, I've got all these things I need to do, and, like, my days just, I blink and they're gone. And I'm like, where is my time going? And I've, like, put my to-do lists into the app, and then I can kind of try and balance and go, well, what needs to be done today and what can slip and be done another day. And using that to really try and focus. Like, for example, today I had to make the pumpkin pie today because the pastry had the 16th as the best before date and I'm going to be away for the next couple of days, so I had to make the pumpkin pie today. I wanted to get this video up today because I'll be away for the next couple of days. Friday, I need to have done all my Christmas cards by Friday, so that'll be like another next thing on my priority list. I need to order cat food because the cat's already run out of cat food. So it's things like that. I'm trying to learn to better keep track of what's urgent, needs to be done now. But the cleaning the high chair harness, the straps need to be cleaned. I've got one second hand. The baby won't be using that for another 4.5 months, so that doesn't need to be done right now. So there's certain things. Same with, like, I got some dolls that I had in my parents' loft that got a bit, they need to be cleaned because there was, like, mold in my parents' loft. The baby won't be getting those for a wee bit longer, so again, not top of the list of the priorities. So I'm kind of trying to balance the things on my to-do list sensibly and learn how to cope and manage and still be effective and get stuff done but not beat myself up. So yeah, basically this is a whispered ramble video. If I didn't mention that in the beginning, apologies, I'll put it in the description. The general gist is that it's highly likely that I have ADHD. There is evidence that I've had it, like, my whole life, and I can see now the signs from when I was a kid. I can see how it affects me as an adult, especially around, like, the time management and distraction or hyper-focusing. And I'm learning things to help me control it better, to manage it better, so that I'm more effective. I've got a bunch of other videos I'd like to do. I'd like to do one about how I've been finding being a parent. I've got a few ideas, a few thoughts. And I apologise because somebody complained about me saying all the time, and I'm still doing it. And as when I do it, I'm suddenly very painful aware that I've done it. And I apologise. That's all I can say. I do try not to, but it's so just ingrained that I do it without realising. I didn't realise how much I did it until. It's like I had a headmaster used to say right at the end of pretty much every sentence. There was another one. And we used to sit in assembly, and when he was giving, like, a lecture or speech or talk or whatever, we would sit and count how many times it right, and it would be ridiculous amounts. So if people were to do the same with how many times I say then it would probably be horrendous. If I ever want to become a teacher, I'll need history teacher used to have something he used to always say, but I can't remember what it was. Yeah, don't remember. Because that's another one we used to count how many times in a period he used to say it. But maybe he's fallen asleep. And so it's the cat. So I was gonna say. Oh, one thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna overhaul my wall. Getting distracted all over the place. I was gonna do a video chatting about the different channels on YouTube that I watch and follow. And I'm also wanting to do an overhaul of my wardrobe. Because it's needing a desperate, like, overhaul. Someone requested some cooking videos. I enjoyed my cooking videos when I did them, and I really like cooking videos when I watch them. I will need to do some more cooking videos, but I need to. My husband's currently ripping apart our kitchen, and it is chaos. So they won't be for a couple more months until he's had a chance to finish overhauling the kitchen. It's like a massive, massive job. There's like plastering being done and a new ceiling being put in and some new walls being done. I mean, it was gutted. We're getting all sorts of faces here. I need to go if I'm gonna get this uploaded before I have to go make dinner. I'm looking forward to having that pumpkin pie. I hope it's turned out well. Just wanted to say thank you if you're still listening. Thank you for listening. I feel like I should give links to ADHD resources if you think you've got it and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, Google search, there's tons of it. There's also lots of good videos here on YouTube. So there's kind of pointers. They'll be able to give you better information than I can. I've just watched some videos and read some articles, and I've found enough information to confirm that that's probably what I've got. But there's also really great resources out there on how to kind of cope if you've got poor executive function, which is what people with ADHD struggle with, the getting stuff done issue. I think the whole explanation of you know what you need to do, but it's just doing it that's the problem. It's a pretty good description. And I've been beating myself up about it for years, and realizing that it's actually just the way my brain is wired. It's gonna help me cut myself some slack. So I'm hoping that, you know, 35 years in, I might be finally figuring out how my brain works. So hopefully I can start being a bit more effective. At the moment, I'm just keeping baby alive, and that's my top priority, but I'm hoping that in time, I can start, building my accountancy business and being effective as an adult, so we'll see how that goes. But anyway, you guys take care, and I will catch you again in a video sometime soon, hopefully.